Live going live. This Hanging On Air is live. I didn't come in with normally the ferocity because it's week 10, and I'm humbled by the magnitude of these games, the magnitude of our fantasy football matchups, and the magnitude of my two partners in crime here on Sunday mornings, Dr. Gene Bramall, good old Matt Waldman. And Waldman, do you see Spencer Ware back up?
I did.
What do you got to do to get Cedric Pierman up the depth chart a little bit in Cincinnati?
I think his football AARP card is already in the mail. So I think we're gonna have to wait for like the seniors edition of some reality show for Pierman to actually get a shot. But you know, the fact that Jay Gruden's immortal words were, "We didn't know what we had," you know.
Right.
Reverend what? Who? Reverend who? You know. Mm-hmm. So you know, I think that's what's going on there.
And you know, Niall Davis for all that. Hey, how about those Arkansas Razorbacks last night? So Clayton Gray. Hope you're enjoying this ride. I hope you all are enjoying this ride. And we're going to jump in because again, hopefully you are a subscriber to Football Guys and you are getting to read Dr. Gene's Game Day Injury Expectations. But we're going to touch on some of the things that are in there. And this has become a thorny injury week. It escalated very quickly, Gene. We had some things that we were worried about. Let's start with the big one tonight and Marshawn Lynch, because we've gotten some light shed from Mike Garofolo, is certainly very trustworthy beat writer that appeared on the 5-Minute Drill. Yeah, on our iPhone, when iPhones were new. Guidance for Lynch owners. Obviously, if you have Thomas Rawls, it's pretty simple because if Lynch is inactive. Well, I shouldn't say it's simple. If Lynch is inactive, you have Rawls, you play Rawls. What if you have both and Lynch is active? And then just what about the people that are deciding about Lynch and earlier options than Lynch? Lots of ins, lots of outs. Like Matt Waldman said before we came on, we need equal signs, we need pluses, we need greater thans, less thans, Gene. Fill in the blanks.
The math of fantasy football does not apply to Marshawn Lynch ever, unfortunately. And this is another one of those weekends where it's hard to say. You were hoping that you would get a positive report this morning. Pete Carroll, through the end of the week, said, you know, he just felt a little something in his abdomen. It's something he's dealt with before. We expect him to play. And then this morning, both Adam Schefter and Ian Rappaport, probably from the same source, called Lynch 50-50 at best to play today and called him, you know, really up in the air as far as a game time decision goes. And we haven't seen that much with Lynch. You know, we've heard that with his back spasms. We've heard it in the past with some of his other muscle strains. But he tends to come up and play, and most times play effectively. And I think you could probably hope that would be the case tonight until Garofolo's report that suggested it was in, quote-unquote, that lower abdomen groin area that makes you think core abdominal, a.k.a. sports hernia. And that's something that we've seen almost every running back that we've heard have it end up look pretty limited. Now, Adrian Peterson in that year where he almost ran for 2,000 yards ran effectively through a sports hernia injury for about 4 or 5 games. But we're talking about an elite running back there, and I think you can say the same thing about Lynch. However, it is a limiting injury. It is a painful injury. We don't know how lingering and limiting it has been. There have been points this year where we've all thought, well, Lynch doesn't really look like himself, and we've heard hamstring, groin, back, those sorts of things, and you have to wonder if maybe all of those issues were cascades from a lingering sports hernia deal, and if that's the case, we may not see Lynch be effective at any point this year, but that's really an impossible question to answer. We just don't know when each thing happened. Is Carroll saying that something's happened in past years and it's not been a problem, or is this something Lynch has been trying to play through all year long? So I'm not going to be able to give you a very good answer here. I hope that you have Thomas Rawls on the bench or somebody else that you trust as a hedge, maybe a Gio Bernard, somebody in that range. I don't know that I would trust an Alfred Blue as your hedge on a Sunday through Monday night situation here. I don't know that you can trust Lynch as much more than a flex at this point. Consider him a risk-reward running back too, if you like. But the matchup isn't great. The injury could possibly be limiting, and he may not even be active.
Yeah, it's funny because I adjusted Lynch's numbers blind without looking at how it would affect his rankings right before we went on the air, and it pushed him down to running back 27. I have him down for 16 touches, 14 carries, and two receptions, and Rawls for 9 carries. And it pushed him down to the level of plays like Eddie Lacy, Joik Bell, Antonio Andrews, Isaiah Crowell, Ronnie Hillman. Does that sound about right, Gene? I mean, just for a fair set of expectations.
Yeah, I think, honestly, it sounds like right now the best case scenario is 10 to 14 touches And against an Arizona defense, even at home, you have to wonder if that means more than 50 to 60 yards. And you're basically crossing your fingers that he gets an effective goal line touch. Now, it could be much more than that. Lynch at home is always a nice play. But this defense, this particular injury, there hasn't been anything really positive over the last 24 hours. I think that's what you're looking at. You're looking at 10 to 14 touches, and hopefully he either breaks a long catch or gets into the end zone.
So, Matt, I'm assuming because of you and I sharing lots of allegiances here that you have some Lynch decisions to make today.
Oh, absolutely. I've got a Thomas Rawls on my bench in a league with multiple running back starts. It's one of those crazy leagues where you can start like five running backs, hyperactive. So I can use I could use Rawls possibly over a player like Rishard Matthews if I wanted to. That would be an option, or maybe weighing between Ryan Matthews and Rawls might be another. And then I have, you know, in our staff league, I have Marshawn Lynch, and I have decent wide receivers. I'm a high scorer in the league, not the high scorer, but a high scorer in the league. But I've got, you know, my running backs right now are down to Isaiah Crowell, Danny Woodhead on bye, and then I'm looking at guys like Joyke Bell, Marcel Reese, you know, right now this week, and having to start Lynch as one of two running backs where I could possibly start four, but it's, you know, likely it's going to be Isaiah Crowell and either Joyke Bell or Marshawn Lynch as a deciding factor, unless I want to go Jay Ajayi and think that maybe, you know, maybe they give him more carries and he does something with them. And that's, you know, none of those are enticing decisions right to make. The symbols I'm getting, and usually they do come this way with Marshawn Lynch, are question marks and exclamation points rather than any type of greater than, less than, or
sure,
equals.
So are you talking yourself into putting him in your lineup, or are you talking yourself into benching him?
I'm still up in the air right now. He's been in my lineup, and I'm probably I'm kind of more leaning towards benching him. But here's the thing. When I hear Gene talk about the possibility, and I know you said it was very slight, the, you know, maybe a sports hernia or something like that, when I watch the way that he moved in recent weeks, I'm a little more leery that it was something like that, unless it just really got worse and deteriorated over, you know, over the past week or two, because I thought he looked quicker in recent weeks. I thought he was more explosive, and a lot of the plays where the, you know, if the offensive line had stopped committing penalties, or they had some, you know, Doug Baldwin decided not to hold that day, there would have been, you know, there would have been at least four or five carries, at least in a game that I saw recently, where he could have been way over the century mark in that game. And they were just called back due to holds. And a lot of it was because he was making things happen after contact or making the right cuts, and somebody just got taken out of position. So I'm a little more optimistic that just from my, I would say, less skilled and no skill at all about, you know, injury type of situations, but just from watching him on tape, I'm more inclined to think that it's a back issue and that it's something that's routine that Pete Carroll truly isn't worried about. It's not I'm trying to play through something really bad.
And if it is something in that groin, abdomen, or sports hernia area, the problem with that is he can play through that. I mean, he can play through that injury. It's a pain tolerance thing, but he won't be the same. So we're going to be watching this closely. Let's just go ahead and knock out the other one from the game tonight, Gene and John Brown. And I don't. And we got a good question from Jared. And Jared, man, I'm sorry. It was the Marine Corps' birthday this week, and I really wish I would have not been scattered and gotten Jared in with us. But he's asking right now on Twitter, you know, and I'm saying this for myself, I still feel confident in John Brown, or I think the reward, let me rephrase this, I think the reward of John Brown is worth taking the risk of another active, inactive, or what have you, because I do see him as the type of wide receiver that Seattle is going to have trouble with, and I think Carson Palmer's not going to be shy at all about taking shots downfield, and you know, hanging in, taking those hits from Michael Bennett as he's about to let the go. Don't do it, Matt, we've already had a couple. You know, I had those cats in my lap a couple weeks ago. You guys don't let me have a straight face, okay? So anyway, Gene, we have this situation, and much like Lynch, another thing that's troubling here, coming out of a bye, you know, you think he's as healthy as he's going to be for the rest of the year coming out of a bye. Not questionable, not a game-time decision. So let's talk about the differences and maybe similarities between Brown and Lynch and the decisions tonight.
Okay, so I fully admit that I may be talking out of my rear end here, as I am sometimes wont to do.
Like I always.
I am moved by the fact that John Brown left Arizona, went to Florida to see his family over the bye week. That does not strike me as something a player who needs intensive treatment and able to play 3 weeks after a hamstring injury would do. And I know he's listed questionable, but we saw him at least healthy enough to be active in case they needed him 2 weeks ago, leave Arizona, and I know he saw his personal trainer out in Florida. That was part of the report as well. But unless something happened early this week when he came back and he got a tweak, and maybe that's possible, I just don't get the sense that this is an injury where we're going to see the same thing happen tonight as happened in Week 8, which is he's active, dresses, and then takes no snaps. That doesn't mean he's going to be effective necessarily, but I just get the sense that of all these players, from Alshon Jeffrey to Calvin Johnson, I'm not buying that John Brown is as questionable as he may seem to be. And again, I may be reading way too much into that particular fact, but knowing that they felt like he was close 2 weeks ago, allowed him to dress 2 weeks ago, allowed him to leave Arizona last week, and then let him practice in limited fashion all week, I just don't see this as a big concern. Now, is he going to get the same number of targets he always gets? I don't know. Michael Floyd's been coming on a little bit. Maybe Arizona approaches this game a little bit differently. The Seattle defense is strong. It's not a perfect spot to trust a player who's not fully practiced and is listed questionable as a game-time decision, but I'm not as concerned about the injury, I guess, as I am the totality of all the factors involved.
So, Matt, you know, again, I'm sure you have some John Brown decisions to make. And I want to know what you think of my assertion that Brown is the type of receiver that would give Seattle's defense some trouble.
I agree that in theory that he very much would be, because Seattle's corners, I mean, while they are very obviously very good, it's really the scheme that they play that I think that gives it that added value, and part of that is because of Earl Thomas. So you're looking at a player who, I think that Seattle does have issues with very speedy receivers who can make plays after the catch as well as get behind a defense. And John Brown is that type of player. Antonio Brown, I believe, did very well against the Steelers, and you know, last time they played the Steelers, and you look at some of the players that have performed well, they're of that John Brown, Antonio Brown ilk. So I agree with that, but in the same league where I have Marshawn Lynch, I also have John Brown. I'm not starting John Brown either. So I don't, and that may be a mistake, but it's a situation where if he's not completely healthy, they rested him against Cleveland. I could see how they rest him another week and they try and get him right. And while it's a big game, I just look at this and think that if he's on the field and he's not completely there, I don't know how much they're going to push him in to that degree. I mean, I think that when they're talking about a true game time decision, when I hear that, I want to believe Gene saying, well, it's not really that big of a deal that it's a game time decision. But when I hear game time decision, that tends to make me want to back away, slowly back away.
In game time decision on a Sunday night game, obviously a problem. Now, in the background here, you know, Seattle's walking the tightrope at this point. They fall to 4-5. You know, nothing is promised in the NFL. And so that factors into the Lynch decision. My prediction for Lynch and Rawls is that Lynch plays, but isn't that effective, and neither of them are good plays tonight. But I think Lynch, it's just hard to imagine if there's any possible way for Lynch to be on the field, even just for the emotional boost he can bring the team, that he's not active because this game is so important. But, and on the flip side, for Arizona, you open up a three-game lead on Seattle with the last game of the season against Seattle in Arizona. Also, Arizona, you know, at this point, they are maybe looking at trying to jockey and catch up. You know, they still play Green Bay, so they can possibly catch up to Green Bay and try to. Well, you know, Green Bay's got their own thing against Minnesota, so
I think
this is a big game anyway.
Yeah, I mean, I think you have to look at Lynch as in a different way if you're going to be optimistic in any way. And the level of optimism that you should have about Lynch is, I would consider him one of those fullback goal line specialists like Mike Tolbert. He'd be in the same class as Mike Tolbert for me, which is if you're going to play him, it's out of desperation and you're thinking, Maybe he gets some goal line situations just enough that he can get one or two touchdowns on minimal carries and have a good day, even though he doesn't have a high volume day. And that's to me the best case scenario for Marshawn Lynch this week. Whereas, I mean, John Brown, I mean, I love the idea of him being a lot more healthy and Gene going, you know, it's not that big of a deal and reading into it. But it's hard for me, as he said very well, the combined factors of Seattle's defense, Michael Floyd and Larry Fitzgerald playing well. And I always thought Fitzgerald was a very good play for Seattle this week as well, because of the fact that he's the guy that is probably going to have Cam Chancellor on him, and we've seen Cam Chancellor have his bad days covering players in the middle of the field, and Michael Floyd can stretch it for them with Fitzgerald on the inside doing his magic.
If I'm in the game planning for Arizona, I'm taking deep. I'm going for the jugular. The ideal scenario here is you land a deep, you hit with a deep shot to Brown or J.J. Nelson. It doesn't have to be Brown if Brown can't really open it up. You take the wind out of the sails of that crowd. And I'm sorry, Seattle, with the way Russell Wilson's playing, Marshawn Lynch not at full speed, if they fall down 7 or 10 points in this game, I think you start to feel them press and get nervous. So this is what a game we have to look forward to. Let's talk about some of the players in the games coming up earlier today, though. Gene, you mentioned these guys. Let's go through them one by one. Alshon Jeffrey, I'm assuming he's going to be active and safe to play. I'm not really even changing my approach to Alshon Jeffrey. What I'm more interested in is the idea that, remember, he came into week one after resting for, 3 weeks, and it was all going to be good, and then he played, and he had, 5 for 70-something that week. Then we didn't see him for, a month and a half. Are we in the danger zone again?
Yeah, I think we're in the danger zone with all of these guys. I got some very good questions after I posted some stuff on Twitter about, do you expect any of these players to run effective routes? Are they going to be more than decoys? Are these teams putting these guys on the field to occupy defensive attention and are going to have to go someplace else because they're not healthy enough to gain separation? I don't think there's any way to know the answer to that, unfortunately, for any of these guys. That includes John Brown, but particularly Alshon Jeffrey and Calvin Johnson. We've seen that happen in the past. These are players, they're elite players that try to force their 90% health to 100% usage, and it's hindsight is the only way we're going to have this answer. I would feel better about Jeffrey knowing what we'd seen in past years, that he was able to play effectively through some of these muscle strains. That's really not been the case this year. I think I'm a little bit reassured that he was able to get through a limited Friday practice. We know that Jay Cutler is going to try to force him the ball, but short of that, whether this is going to be a 4-5 target day or a 10-15 target day is going to be impossible to know without some sort of positive report, which we're not going to get. All we got from Schefter and Rappaport and everybody else this morning was that expected to play. Right. It's really not much more other than that. We're not going to get anything else out of Chicago. So I think this is a situation where you're just going to have to go with whatever your gut's telling you. If you're comfortable with using a player of Jeffrey's caliber, knowing that his floor is lower than usual, but he's probably got his similar ceiling, then you roll with him. But that's really the best I can do, is say lower than usual floor, usual ceiling, and cross your fingers that he hits the ceiling.
And I had him, when the week started, I had him in wide receiver 4 or 5 for the week. I moved him down to wide receiver 14. He's roughly in the range of guys like Jarvis Landry, Larry Fitzgerald, who Matt brought up, Eric Decker, who already went, Brandon Cooks. These are the guys I'm weighing Jeffrey against. But Matt, in the background here, with Kouatu here to lead the revolution, St. Louis is rough, man. That's a rough matchup for Jay Cutler and company. Jay Cutler's playing really well, but as it was, this was not going to be easy going for the Bears' offense today. And this implicates Jeremy Langford, too, and we'll talk a little bit about Matt Forte. Confidence, optimism about Jeffrey today with the injury is just one of the things we have to consider.
Yeah, I mean, I think that the hope is that he can do some good work in the red area if they can get to the red area and often enough to target him. And I think that if they let him play rebounder in the short area of the field, that you could have some success there. Then otherwise, it's going to be dependent on whether Martellus Bennett and Marcus Wilson can actually get them into the red area along with a guy like Langford. And I think it's possible, because the thing about to me, the Chicago Bears offense is about on par with the Minnesota Vikings offense. And while the Vikings didn't have a great week last week either, they were able to move the ball up and down the field to some degree. And I think that Cutler's playing as well as a guy like Teddy Bridgewater was before Gruella DeVille's henchman came and knocked him out. But you look at that situation, and I think that Marcus Wilson is kind of a swing for the fences flex play if you're desperate. I also think that I'm looking at Jared Plotz's tweet right now. I'm trying not to laugh, but you know the I just got to. Anyway, you look at the situation, and it's really dependent on the fact that St. Louis makes mistakes. They are an aggressive defense, and aggressive defenses oftentimes make errors, and that's something that I think that Cutler is good at being able to exploit on some level, but that often it comes down to the defensive line versus that offensive line, and I'm not confident enough in Chicago's offensive line to be able to take care of that. So, looking at it from this standpoint, I could see where Langford as a receiver has a decent day. I can see where, Alshon Jeffrey could have a touchdown in this game, but not a big yardage total or a big reception total. And then your wild card is if the Bears have a shot at winning this game, it's going to be because Cutler and Marcus Wilson actually connect. And I'm not completely I'm not very optimistic about that. On the other note, Ian Rappaport says that John Brown, Calvin Johnson are expected to play.
Yeah, and Calvin Johnson, I'd lead us right into Calvin Johnson, Gene. And again, in the background here is everybody who owned Calvin Johnson the last 2 years can tell you, oh no, when his playing availability starts to become in question, then his quality of play starts to become in question, and we haven't seen him be a quick healer. We haven't seen him be somebody who just in a week or two looks like old Calvin Johnson. In the background here, if you own Golden Tate, if you own Eric Ebron, remember, Golden Tate was basically a wide receiver one when Johnson was out or just not himself last year, and then back to what you've had this year, which is a flex play, a fringe value. So this has a lot of ripple effects, Gene. Other than today, and you give us your feelings about Calvin Johnson today, are we at least on guard for a repeat of the last 2 years?
Yeah, I think we have to be on guard. Johnson, I'm less confident about Johnson than I am Jeffrey, and I'm not super confident about any of these guys. The Jeffrey Hearns Johnson crew is, I don't really know what's going to happen today. Johnson said this week that this injury wasn't as bad as the high ankle sprain that cost him 3 weeks last year, but that doesn't mean it's not
exactly okay.
It doesn't cost 2 to 3 weeks.
You know that, yeah.
So, I don't know. He's insistent that he's going to play, and assuming that he's that insistent, you would think that he'd be able to run effective routes, but there's no guarantee of that. And the Packers defense has been off and on, but we're talking about a Packers defense at home, and it's good enough. So there's just no way to know. It's the same. I'm more confident about Jeffrey and Johnson is all that I feel comfortable saying, and I would be nervous about him today. And it's a situation where we're not going to know until we look back and say, well, yeah, this is what he was saying. He said he was good to go all week long, and he caught 10 passes for 120 yards and a touchdown, and everything was fine. Or, he said it was not as bad as his 3 weeks last time, but it was still easy to see in those words that it was a difficult injury for him to play through, and he did very little. And it's, without knowing exactly what he's going through, it's impossible to say how close to limit he is versus how close to not limited he is.
So, Matt, let's get into... You're one of the few people that you'll go there with me on this. Let's try to put the Lions team on the couch and psychoanalyze them for a second, okay? Because the last time we saw them, they gave up. They just looked like a team that gave up in London. Now, that was after they had let go Joe Lombardi. In the bye, they let go their Martin Mayhew. The last vestiges of that Matt Millen regime, Tom Lewand. Jim Caldwell's still there, though. So what are we going to see? It's a divisional battle at Green Bay where they haven't won since the 90s. Are we going to see a Lions team show up and be competitive in this game? Or is this when Aaron Rodgers in the rough, Carolina-Denver stretch for Green Bay, we all put that behind us. Like he said last year, relax. It's just the Lions. We're going to have a good day.
This is a team that I think they don't need a therapist. They need Dr. Phil. I think that's what they really need. They just need one of those grandstanding pseudo used to be, respectable medical right. practitioners of some sort, kick them in the hind parts, you know, and just keep kicking them until they move the ball up and down the field and stop their opponent. That's like, they need some sort of like Hollywood crazy therapy. I don't know. But the way that I would honestly look at it is I don't think Green Bay's performed well enough to even feel like that this is completely a get better situation. I don't, you know, I mean, maybe James Jones and Randall Cobb go off finally at this point and can get open. And you look at James Starks and he can certainly run the ball. We know that he's a good football player. I would say that if I had to, you know, you obviously have to make a decision on these. I would still lean in the favor of that this is going to be a get better day for Green Bay, even though it's, to me, a false positive than it will be a true they finally turned it around type of scenario, because I don't think Green Bay can beat the top teams in the league right now. But Detroit is so far from that it may at least make Green Bay's fans feel good before Thanksgiving. And I guess if you're a fantasy owner, yeah, you got to start those two receivers. You got to consider Richard Rodgers in the middle of the field here. I think that he could be a decent play. And certainly James Starks. I mean, you know, we've seen what he can do. So, I don't think that Detroit is going to be able to hang with them very well. You know, I mean, but it's the same old situation. If Joik Bell gets enough carries, if Calvin Johnson gets enough touches, if somebody removes Golden Tate from the closet that he's locked in by, you know, somebody locked him in some sort of equipment training room or something and not letting him play. So maybe we need to see where Mike Leach is at before we, you know, right. start this game and find the key. But otherwise, yeah, I mean, it's just the same usual suspects.
They've been treating him like basically he's Percy Harvin out there on the field, at least tactically.
Dumb.
Yeah, maybe this opens up a little bit, and then we'll watch the backfield too. We'll watch Amir Abdullah's role is growing. Not that it really matters. It may not matter because this team. I agree with you that this week Joik Bell is a good flex. If they can hang in the game, he could be a great flex play.
Yeah, but is Amir Abdullah growing like grass is growing, or is he growing like you know the way Kwato just kind of came out of
right.
Came out of Dr. Jean's
like mold or something yeah. like a fungus. Yeah. Gene, let's just touch on really quickly because it doesn't implicate today's games, but what we more know, because as we continue to talk about, thank you, John Fox, thank you, Bears, for leaving us out in the cold here, but it sounds like you have some insight because based on Forte practicing this week, well, hey, he's going to return for Denver next week, but you're seeing some signs that we shouldn't pencil him in the lineup next week.
No, I think that's the goal. I think, you know, as we said from the beginning, and now that Forte has confirmed that it's an MCL sprain, I think the reason that you do PRP is that you see a 4 to 6 weeks injury that you're trying to cut to 3 to 4, that you want to be sure that's on the, you know, the lower end of that recovery timetable. And next week would be 3 weeks, which would be the earliest you would expect him back. But he was talking that last week was really difficult for him. He still had some swelling in the knee this week. And maybe all of that irons itself out in time to play, but I think that, you know, what we're seeing is more conditioning possibly with anything else. I still think there's a good chance that we see him in week 11, but as you said, pencil him in at best. He needs to show some more recovery. He has to be more confident in his knee than what he was on Friday when he didn't sound confident at all. And as we talked about with every MCL injury this year, it has as much to do with comfort level with movement in the knee and whether or not it feels too loose or too stiff than it does pain. And every one of those injuries heals at its own rate, and the simple fact that they decided to do that PRP injection to accelerate the healing tells you that it was an injury that wasn't going to heal quickly anyway. And yes, there are studies that suggest that the PRP injections accelerate healing time in mid to high grade MCLs, but every single situation is different. So until we see him on the field saying he feels comfortable and isn't dealing with any of the inflammation and swelling that he's dealt with over the past 7 to 10 days, then I don't think we can reliably expect him to play. So hopefully we see him next week, but don't count on it just yet.
Right. And with the limited practices, it might have felt like, oh, he's on track to, you know, they're getting him in that reconditioning period. And I think Gene is very wise to point out. And Jeremy Langford owners, this affects you. And those of you that have tried to pull a trade on the sly for Forte near the trade deadline because he's injured now and you can get him for cheap. Well, you know, you might not get him back as quickly as you think. And we'll see about all that. Gene, as you said, you've alluded to it a few times, Emmanuel Sanders, and as it is, you're being very judicious and telling people, not so much optimism, but here's some reasons to not be as pessimistic. You're not really giving us any nudges to play Emmanuel Sanders today.
No, I don't think so. In fact, at this point, you have to be surprised whether or not he's active. There's not been a single positive report since Friday. I know he was able to play through this injury last week. It was hard to see exactly what happened, but this sounds more and more like a pretty concerning ankle sprain when, you know, you see a player sort of fight through with adrenaline, not effectively, but still play through the injury in 1 week, basically not be able to practice at all, tried to do a little bit on Friday and was too sore to continue, didn't feel much better on Saturday, and now we're hearing that it's a struggle. And even Cecil is saying he's on the doubtful side of questionable at this point. So of all the players that you think might be out there running decoy routes and occupying defensive personnel, it's Sanders this week, and I don't feel strongly that he's going to be active much more than that. So I don't see any way he can be in your lineup.
And that's an afternoon start. Luckily, a lot of the teams playing in the late and night games have viable wide receivers that may be on the waiver wire. So if you're hearing this, you're like, what am I going to do? Hopefully you have someone to start in the early games, but go forward without Sanders. I have Sanders. I mean, I'm still projecting him to give people guidance if he is active. He's down around the level of plays like Chris Givens, you know, Tyler Lockett, Pierre Garçon. Like, yeah, it could work out, but you know, the history and what we're seeing coming in makes us feel a little more pessimistic. And so I'll toss this one up, Matt, and you can either, because we're on the subject of this Denver KC game, you can either spike this one down like a volleyball back in my face, or you can set it up and spike it for everybody on behalf of taking advantage of this hunch. I think this is going to be CJ Anderson day. Everything in my mind points towards CJ Anderson triumphantly reasserting himself in this backfield, reestablishing himself in the fantasy football world as somebody who can help us win championships again. I see he's over the toe injury. And Gene, do you want to comment on that at all? Like it looked like he was playing with a toe injury now, especially that we've seen him play the last 2 weeks and how he looks after the bye?
No, I think that's probably accurate.
So he's over the toe injury. Peyton Manning is dinged up, which we haven't talked about. Now he's added with ribs in addition to this foot injury. You're going to protect him by not leaning on him as heavily. You're going to, and plus you want the running game to get established for January anyway. I mean, this is a major goal of this team to start to get this all in sync. Anderson's outplaying Hillman. Denver has acknowledged that they're reevaluating who the starting running back is, which is almost like just setting the predicate so that when Anderson goes out and gets 20 carries and Hillman gets 10, then it makes sense based on what they've been telling us. And they're at home against Kansas City, Alex Smith, and so on. No Jamal Charles. It's a game they can control. It's a game, what do we love in fantasy football running backs? Good defenses. Those go together like peanut butter and jelly, peanut butter and chocolate, man. So all these things, and now we have an Emmanuel Sanders. So Kansas City can put Marcus Peters on Demaryius Thomas. Who's your top threat? Owen Daniels, you know? So spike this one back at me or spike it down for a potential score, because I want to tell you this, folks. I'll dabble a little DFS. I did a Thursday lineup just to see percentages because I was just curious. I mean, it was just more for my, like a $1 research lineup. Anderson, 0.2%. Nobody's on Anderson this week, Matt. What do we think?
I'm on your side of the net, and I'm ready to spike it. So I think that it's a good idea. I mean, when you look at – we went from Detroit and talking about how there's really not much there other than some of the usual suspects, and it's kind of a hope and a prayer even against a Green Bay defense that's a little bit suspect. Last week against – or a couple weeks ago against Kansas City, we're talking about, you know, 13 carries for 86 yards out of the Detroit running backs. That's pretty darn good for an offense that doesn't know what it is, doesn't have an offensive line that plays in sync in any way, shape, or form, and Matthew Stafford, who does need some sort of football therapy. So, I mean, I would look at this and be somewhat optimistic about C.J. Anderson. I'm certainly starting him in the leagues where I have him and have that choice. And, you know, looking even further beyond that, I mean, Le'Veon Bell had 17 carries for 121 yards the week prior to that. While Adrian Peterson had a slower week, you know, and it was 26 for 60, he did have a touchdown in that game. Matt Forte
and they called out to stop Peterson.
Yeah, exactly. Game, and totally you got to understand that. You have to understand Forte and Peterson are two two teams where they didn't have much really there to where you could sell out and say, we just dare you to beat us throwing the football. So, I mean, because prior to that, I mean, if you have some level of balance, and certainly the Cincinnati Bengals show that, you're looking at them having 22 carries for 102 yards and 4 touchdowns against Kansas City's defense on the ground. So I do like this, and I think it's a very good idea to consider C.J. Anderson for your lineups in both weekly, and both DFS and in-season.
And in the vein of last-second trades before the games kick off today, I mean, I think this is going to herald Anderson in the second half of the season being a fantasy factor again. So if you can swing the trade, and I unfortunately traded him away in one league. This is probably what's going on here. I'm putting myself on the couch. I have so much remorse that I'm overcompensating. But let's go back to a very level-headed Gene Bramble and Alan Hurns. Now, Gene, at the beginning of the week, I had Hurns probably in my top 15. Then we started to hear about this foot issue, and it was really going into Friday. If he didn't practice on Friday, probably could rule him out. He did practice on Friday. I had moved him down on Thursday all the way down to, you know, about that range we're talking about, Emmanuel Sanders, you know, the wide receiver 35 or so. Now I've moved him back up to around wide receiver 20. Actually, he and John Brown are projected very similarly for me. Or somebody like Willie Snead, somebody that you look at and say, I can see the makings of a big game. I won't be surprised necessarily. I don't feel like it's a lead pipe lock that it's a big game, but I can see it. Brandon LaFell is another player in that range for me. Martavis Bryant is another player in that range for me. James Jones is another player in that range for me. So this isn't about my projections, but I'm trying to give people some context here. As you give much more specific empirical information on how players have played with foot injuries. Now with Hurns, I want to say, is this something that is not new with Hurns, and he's been playing with it to an extent? Go ahead.
I think he's been playing with a little bit of everything. And as we talked about on Thursday night, the concern with Hurns is it's been the participation report has been not practicing on Wednesday, getting rest and treatment, doing some limited work on Thursday, and then either limited or generally full practice on Friday. And he wasn't able to do any of that other than a limited practice on Friday this week. However, coming off the field, he seemed very confident that he'd been able to play. They asked Allen Robinson about him in the locker room, and they said, I've got a really good feeling that he'll be out there going. And we have seen Hurns play. So this could be just a combination of factors where there's a little bit more going on. He was a little bit more sore. There's more than one injury now, even though I imagine these things have probably been minor injuries as the entire course of the season has progressed. But I don't think there's any concern whether or not he'll be active or not. I think he's going to play. And like so many of these other players, I've got Hurns behind Jeffrey and ahead of Johnson as far as my confidence level of how these guys are going to play today. But you could shake them up in a hat and pull them out, and it could go differently. So I think the matchup certainly is in favor of Hurns here, so you'd give him a little bit of a nod there. And I think he's going to play. I don't know that he's going to get his usual 8 to 10 targets, but with this matchup, it's only going to take a couple for him to be valuable in your lineups.
Yeah, the 60-yard touchdown, the six-game scoring streak. So, Matt, looking at Jacksonville, Marquise Lee's going to be back today. Confetti, yay. Rashad Green is going to be back next week, and I know that's one where you actually say, like, no, this is good. Julius Thomas, he and Blake Bortles haven't been clicking yet, but there's talking. They want to get it going. We know Jacksonville's defense isn't going to do them any favors. And then, like Gene said, the matchup today against Baltimore is great. But then I'm looking ahead, Matt, and I'm looking at the matchups after that. Tennessee, San Diego, Tennessee, Indy, Atlanta, and the coup de grace, the pièces de résistance in Week 16 against New Orleans. Yeah. So is the Jacksonville offense and the pass offense, is it going to be a key to winning fantasy leagues this year? Can we believe the numbers in the first half going ahead? Can we believe this?
Yeah, absolutely. Though it's hard for me to believe Julius Thomas getting back into it. I mean, he might. I mean, he may need that bike trainer like I do back in my background of my shot, because I'm listening to I was listening to some of the game this week and watching it and hearing some of the commentators go, well, we were asked about Julius Thomas possibly having a weight issue or a conditioning issue, and the coach said, ask him. So when the coach says, ask him, that says to me, will you please light a fire under this guy who just got paid? So I'm a little curious about whether or not there's that dynamic going on. Marquise Lee, I mean, yeah, I mean, very great talent, can't hold on to the ball in traffic, and you know, we as I've joked, I've named the phenomenon of trying to, you know, gain a bit, trying to, you know, losing 10 to 15 yards to gain two is, you know, a Marquise Lee type of move. So I'm not all that enthusiastic about him, but certainly if Hearns can get a little bit healthier and Rashad, or just hang in there and Rashad Green can come back, I think that they will have, you know, they'll have enough in that rotation to continue this type of production. I think Blake Bortles is continuing to play well. You just look at what he does in the pocket, and yes, he still makes some dumb decisions at the end of games, and he's not, you know, giving you the heroics that spell the difference between being a very good starter and being a competent starter. You know, that's kind of the difference, those 1 to 2, 1 to 3 plays each game. But when you see what he has to do in the pocket to climb and find an open man, he's always been pretty good at that, and I think he's getting, you know, incrementally better, more, I would say, acclimated to the speed and to the way the NFL pockets compress. And he's doing, you know, he's doing the things that he did as a junior at, or a senior at UCF. So I like this offense. I was starting Bortles this week against Baltimore in some of these weekly lineups just to give him a shot here. I'll see whether, you know, after listening to Gene talk about Hearns a little bit, I may reevaluate that a little bit, but I'm still optimistic about him this season moving forward.
Yeah, I think that this is going to be one of those ones where, and you're right, he's playing well. Well, he's playing well like 80% of the plays. And on the 20% or so that he's not playing well, he just looks horrid at times. But it all counts the same when you add it up at the end of the day. By the way, going back to Alshon Jeffrey and Matt Forte, Adam Hodge just brought up on Twitter a really good point. The Bears are going to play 3 games in the next 12 days. And the games are against the Rams, Broncos, and Packers. We'll see. We'll see. Okay, Gene, this one doesn't necessarily affect our lineups today, but Austin Seferian-Jenkins, now we're hearing, and Seferian-Jenkins alluded to this, and now we've seen a specific report that he's not physically cleared to play. This is odd. I can't recall another situation, Gene, where we've seen a player practicing for weeks and not physically cleared to play the way that Seferian-Jenkins has, knowing it's a shoulder injury. Is there a story we can tell that makes sense out of this?
The story is it's a much more severe injury than maybe even they expected it to be in the beginning, because we heard 4 to 6 weeks was sort of the expectation. I speculated this morning that it still worries me that maybe there's a collarbone fracture involved. You know, maybe it's a labral tear, maybe it's something else there. But, those things, if you think it's going to be a 4 to 6 to 8 week injury, those things generally get repaired with surgery. And I sort of think that's why I'm leaning more towards something bony. When you say he's not been cleared for contact yet,
right?
I don't know. It's odd. It makes you wonder. You know, with I don't know if it was Garofalo or Rappaport. It was Rappaport, right? Said he hinted that he may not. It still may be a few weeks before he's cleared now.
Right.
So there's something going on. It's difficult to say exactly what it is, but when you see a player that's come back and practiced for a couple of weeks, and he was listed as full last Friday. You wonder if there's something else going on there. Was there some sort of setback that's occurred? Are they considering surgery? Just it becomes a player. It's rare to see a player that comes back in practice that you consider to still be indefinitely out. Something odd is going on here. Don't count on him being back anytime soon. But on the other hand, you know, maybe this is all just a bunch of smoke. We've not heard anything specific out of Tampa Bay, and we do see him back next week. But I think I'd lean toward the former in this case, and he's back when he's back.
So this is a discussion, Gene, that might be more for Thursday night or a larger topic. So I understand if the answer is just like, that's a complicated question with a complicated answer. But return to play clearance by doctors. And I understand it might vary between injuries and it may vary between severity of a specific injury. But is there a subjective element where the doctor's asking the player, like, how does it feel when I do this? And the player's answers to those questions determine the clearance and not something like an MRI or an X-ray or a test, a very objective test result?
Yeah, it's very dependent on the injury. So if you're talking about something bony where you can do an imaging study and see exactly where the healing process is, and we know that there are some medical staffs that are a little bit more likely to clear a player with a muscle strain when it's not fully healed, and maybe that's, you know, all of those things are subjective, from exam to imaging to player report to all of those things. So, you know, as we'll see with, I think a lot of it, you know, sometimes comes down to you present the case to the team who has the investment in the player, and the player who ultimately has to go out and take the risk of injury. This is where you are. This is what could happen if you could play. This is what might happen if you don't play this week. And then you try to come to a reasonable decision, knowing that even if you've got the player report, the imaging studies, the exam findings, the experience of knowing how this player responds to injury in the past, all of which we don't have talking here on Sunday morning, there's still unknowns involved, and you could say that about Marshawn Lynch this week. Yes, a player like him is tough and wants to play through these injuries, and Seattle really doesn't have time for him to take off 4 to 6 weeks, as Arian Foster did to come back from this injury at this point. He's got to play, and so you weigh the risk benefits just like anything else with these injuries. So you take all of those things into account, and it very much is a case-by-case situation.
Very difficult to determine this. Matt, I want to ask you about this Tampa-Dallas game in the backfield, because you very correctly were bullish on Doug Martin in the preseason, and you liked the narrative of Dirk Koetter stumping for his guy. He's made Koetter look smart. There were a lot of reports that the rest of the coaching staff was more of a Charles Sims guy. Now, last week, Doug Martin fumbles, and Charles Sims gets a good quarter or so plus to himself, and was reasonably productive. You know, you can see Sims doing more this year and looking speedier, a little more resourceful as a runner. Now, Sims also fumbled in this game. In the background is Sean Lee is out, and Dallas's defense that has been underrated and outperforming expectations without Sean Lee against the run maybe doesn't outperform expectations. So there may be a good play in the Tampa backfield, but if this is trending towards a 50-50 backfield, maybe there isn't. What does your crystal ball say? And this isn't so much what we think should happen, because I think Martin, for as good as Sims has looked, Martin has looked tremendous, like even the equal of Devontae Freeman when they were on the same field a few weeks ago. But we know from the preseason and offseason that the coaches are not necessarily of one mind about this backfield. Do you have any guidance here, Matt?
Yeah, I mean, first of all, though, I would say that the caption for this is motorboat that, Cecil. So, you know, but that, or we could say this is how Marshawn
I was just
feeling on Sunday, you know.
As you all may have seen out there, I was eating some brisket. So, Matt, you know, I'm going to keep that down through the rest of the show.
Okay, well, you know, that was my response to you having that Franklin's brisket in the first place. So there we go. Let's stop sharing that.
Yes, please.
Yes, okay.
You know, somebody in my sixth graders class Googled me this week because of some stuff they were doing with Google, and had some questions for me when he got in the car about some of Five-ish's creations over the past few years. Dad, what is going on when I Google you? So thanks, Jared.
Oh, wow.
We'll add that to the mix. It was only a matter of time. Part of me is glad that it's the sixth grade class rather than one of my patients, but that's going to happen soon too.
Yeah.
Thanks, well, Jared.
But yeah, back to Tampa Bay. I would say this: Dirk Koetter, I think, convinced that coaching staff fairly well that Doug Martin was the guy to hang on to and to give him another chance. And I think the coaching staff bought into that very early on. I mean, you could see where this was supposed to be a, you know, coaching staff drafts Charles Sims. That's our guy. 1 week in the training camp. 1 week. They're like, no more competition. Doug Martin is our starter. After a week, that tells you right then and there. I mean, this wasn't like Atlanta going, well, we may have a split with Devonta Freeman and Tevin Coleman, and yeah, Freeman looks like our guy, but then he got hurt, and let's start Coleman. Now, this was like, you know, Levy Smith saying, Martin's our guy, and now he just needs to produce like we know he can. Like, you better bring it, because we know what you can do. We're going to give you one more chance. I think that Martin has done enough to prove himself and that they took him off the field because it was kind of a message to send that was like, look, this is a young team. This is a team that has played well. They just beat Atlanta. They're coming off that victory, and he wanted to say, no one is immune to being benched, and they need to make sure that these guys play well. And Sims has played well, even as the second back in this lineup. You know, the burst has been there, the decisiveness has been there, and certainly the holes continue to be there. I've kind of liked Martin this week against Dallas. I still believe that – I don't believe 1 week is a trend, and I know that we have to make those tough calls, and sometimes that there's enough to give us a, you know, pause and make us, you know, think, well, maybe this is the start of it, and we need to be out ahead of it. So I applaud you, Sigmund, for taking that stand and saying that there's a possibility that Charles Sims now is trending towards him. But in this case, I think Martin is still a markedly better back. I think the Tampa Bay Buccaneers know this. I think that it's been pretty obvious to see. And Sims, to me, is a valuable handcuff or guy to pick up if Martin gets hurt. But I believe they'll give him another chance today against Dallas. And I think if Hitchens, I don't know, you'll have to tell me, Gene, if Hitchens is gone too, I think he's playing.
Both he and McLean are playing. I don't know how healthy any of them are going to be or how effective they'd be, but they're both going to be active today.
Yeah, well, if they propped them up with a little cardboard backing triangle thing there, then I still think that Doug Martin and company will have a pretty good day, and he's someone I have some shares with.
Very good
week
day.
And weekly.
Very good day for Tampa Bay backfield running game today. And as you've learned, if you've been following us here on Sunday mornings, if I say anything that perhaps even makes Matt think about changing his DFS lineups, then go the opposite of whatever I'm saying. So,
yeah, I mean, the joke is I could exaggerate and say I've lost thousands of dollars because I've listened to Bloom.
Thousands of
pennies. No, that's not true. You know, but I have certainly had some really good lineups that I've changed because I trust my buddy here.
Yeah, I plant the seed of doubt, and you're like, I have to go back and look at that.
Yeah, I got to go back.
Don't go back and look at that. We just got a couple more minutes. I want to touch on some of the matchups really quick before we get into these matchups, Gene. I want to ask you just because over the years, sometimes that waiver wire move I make right before kickoff on Sunday that doesn't actually affect my lineup, but is something I'm doing more forward looking, can be a move that is pivotal when the season's said and done. Malcolm Floyd is going to try to play through this torn labrum. Now, we know that San Diego doesn't, I mean, part of the reason he's probably trying to play through it, other than this is his final year and Wyoming Cowboys baby, and we're big fans of Malcolm Floyd on this show, is they don't, you know, they're losing important pieces of this passing attack. Phillip Rivers is going to throw 40, 45 times a game, probably. The running game isn't getting going. Malcolm Floyd, if he can play effectively through this injury, I'm sure he was dropped when he got hurt by some people. He's on bye. He's probably out there. How reasonably likely is it that he can be enough of himself to be a fantasy factor playing through a torn labrum?
It's going to be tough. The routes that Malcolm Floyd runs and how he is generally effective going up and getting the ball on downfield passes, it's going to be difficult for him to do. I'm still not convinced that this torn labrum didn't occur because he dislocated his shoulder. I think I got a glimpse of, as they were going to commercial, them trying to relocate that shoulder on the field. He was down for a long time. I think they decided that they were going to try to get that shoulder back in place while he was there. You kind of saw the way he was holding that arm. That's something that commonly happens after a shoulder is put back in place and they're walking back to make sure there aren't any associated injuries in the x-ray machine. And torn labrum and cartilage injuries similar to that happen when there are shoulder dislocations. So the concern for me would be if he lands the right way, if he takes another hip this soon after that came out of place, even with a harness, if that's in fact what happens, that he's at risk of having that happen again pretty soon. So I don't know how easy it's going to be for him to get his arms away from the body to make catches. He's at risk of coming out of the game at any point due to pain, either because of the labrum or because the shoulder's still loose. I'd be pretty leery about using him.
So he's not that savior. Matt, if you made the pickup last week of Jay Ajayi, maybe he's the savior. How excited are you about Ajayi for the second half of the season, and how worried should Lamar Miller owners be about this?
I added Ajayi to lineups, and I'm actually considering starting him over Marshawn Lynch this week as kind of a hedge. Either he or Joyke Bell are kind of my only options here. So he's a guy that I'm considering. Watching the game, I was excited about what he did. You could see the burst, definitely the tackle-breaking ability. We all know that he was one of the better receivers in this draft class. Not quite as good as David Johnson, but certainly in that realm of, one of the top two to three guys catching the ball out of the backfield. The difference is that I think a lot of people are excited about Ajayi because they see all that movement, they see that burst, they see him breaking tackles and the balance there. But let's not downgrade Lamar Miller's skill. Okay, and I think that people tend to look at Lamar Miller, and because he's a more compact runner in terms of his gait, he's a more mature, smoother type of player that, you know, that people casually look at these two backs and go, I like Ajayi more because he breaks more tackles and he just looks like he's working harder and he looks like that he's got more energy. And I think that it's really about that Ajayi is just not as an intelligent of a runner as Lamar Miller ever, you know, as Lamar Miller. Lamar Miller was always a smooth player who kind of like a linebacker in space who is able to kind of re-diagnose, make a minimal of movement, and then get to where he needs to be. And I think that Miller does that. It just, it looks more effortless, and people get more excited about running backs who display a lot of effort, you know, or a lot of movement. And yeah. So Ajayi down the line could be a factor for this team, and I definitely see him as a terrific option to put at the end of your roster if Lamar Miller gets hurt. But I would also say that it's a scenario where that you also have to consider him as, you know, a guy that maybe gets 6 to 8 touches per game and can be that low-end bye week flex play for out of desperation who you might hit big on.
If Miami can't control games. If Miami could control a game, they'd probably give him 15 or 18 carries. But they're not going to today against Philly, not with their defense, not with Philly. As Sam Bradford said, we're starting to figure out what we do well. And I don't think this is going to be a great game for Miami's offense. So I'll toss you a hot potato here, Gene. Is Kirk Cousins against New Orleans? Sure thing, because of the matchup. Or it's Kirk Cousins.
I like Kirk Cousins a little bit better based on what I've been hearing about DeSean Jackson. It opens up the outside of the field a little bit. Pierre Garçon has been too limited to do all that much. Jordan Reed is back and healthy. And I think both of those things play well for Cousins. We've seen the New Orleans defense get just beat up against the passing game over the past couple of weeks, and the game's in Washington. Kirk Cousins is always prone to throwing 3-4 interceptions and struggling, but I think the weapons are there for him to have a good game today.
Matt, are you going to trust Martavis Bryant with Landry Jones today?
Yes, I am going to trust him. I actually think that Landry Jones has played pretty good football, and once he kind of gets into the flow of the game, that he's able to target downfield fairly well. And when I say downfield, within that 15 to 25 yard range, and so I'm good with that. I'll give it a shot because we've seen Martavis Bryant do very well on dig routes.
Boomer Sooner, a big night last night for Oklahoma. And again, who would think that out of all those quarterbacks? Matt Barkley and Ryan Nassib and God, I don't know why. Speaking of Razorbacks, I keep spacing Wilson. I'm thinking of Oklahoma and Travis Wilson. Anyway, my point is this, that all these quarterbacks, Landry Jones was the one that you could get anybody in the draft community be like, well, Landry Jones is the one guy that's definitely not the guy. Of all these quarterbacks, it's definitely not Landry Jones. He's going to have the best NFL career out of all those quarterbacks. A couple more things as we hit. Gene, do we trust any Cleveland Browns with Johnny Manziel?
Gary Barnage.
Really?
Any of them? I mean, of any of them that you might be able to trust.
So you're saying he's the one that you would trust if you have to play any?
I think he's the most likely to get useful targets, yes. I don't know that I would. I think he's still within consideration for the top 6 tight ends this week. We'll put it that way. I think he's been effective enough that if Manziel can get the ball anywhere near him, Barnage will be okay.
I'm very interested to see if the Steelers have changed their approach with him. That's true.
I noticed that. I noticed as I was going through some of our stuff this week, you were not high on Barnage at all. What are you seeing in the Steelers' defense?
Well, I mean, I'm persuaded by Stephen White's terrific, terrific article that he wrote. And as somebody who thought that Manziel was going to find ways to make this better, and I think it's still early in his development, and maybe this, you know, sets him back enough because he's playing, and we've talked about the imprinting and how hard it is to break bad habits once they get a few games to really sink in. But Stephen White made this really compelling case about, I mean, it is some of the fatal flaw analysis on him. I've got to say I was wrong and people were right, at least to this point, that Manziel just does not give plays a chance in the pocket. He's just not doing it. And whatever the design is, players are coming open, and he's not sitting in and hitting them. And so there might be all kinds of plays called where the matchup's there and Barnage gets open and there should be production. Now, what I'm especially interested to see is what I did notice when I broke down Manziel was that the longer he did stay in the pocket, the more likely something really bad was going to happen. Because he would just get kind of like he was getting static on his radio. And if the Steelers mush rush and just keep him in the pocket, then this could actually be a terrific day for the Pittsburgh Steelers defense, which has been opportunistic in making big plays. So I've got
a couple. Steelers know how to do that? Do they actually know how not to, like, go all out?
Keith Butler has been, I mean, whatever Keith Butler has been doing, and our mutual friend and opponent, all three of us in a league, Steve Volk, was actually right to be kind of optimistic about the Steelers' defense looking better than expected because of Butler's leadership. And they've been kind of a bend-but-don't-break defense. But I think you're right that, like, they're all about laying the big hit. They're all about making the big play. They're not about playing, like, measured, disciplined
defense. That's not, yeah, that's not AFC North football. I mean, I don't think mush rush and AFC North football are even synonymous remotely, no. Are they?
No, they're not. No, they're not. And see, and here's karma for you guys, is that our kittens have gotten into this room, and there's a little bit of the brisket left over. So I'm being totally bombarded by kittens right now. So
that's, and you're wearing, and you've got a Cleveland Browns bedspread there. So
I do, even though I'm wearing my Steelers shirt here from the great
which,
from the
but shirt. Of course, that's why, you know, if they're doing what they're doing on that bed, then we understand why you have that orange bread.
Well, spread and maybe this is the sign when I mentioned Johnny Manziel and the cats swoop down, because that's what's going to happen. We're going to swoop down on a terrific Sunday of football. Very exciting. I really feel like this is the week that it gets serious. Yeah, week 10 is when we click into a higher gear. The games we have. Again, folks, I just want to emphasize this. Football's it's such a wonderful spectacle to get caught up in, and the games we have coming up. We didn't even talk about the Giants and the Patriots. One of the best matchups in the NFL over the last 8 years. The Arizona-Seattle game, that Denver-KC game we talked about. Minnesota-Oakland we barely talked about. Teddy Bridgewater and Derek Carr. So, oh, all right, I got to stop the madness behind me. Thanks, everybody. We'll be back at you as we always are. You stay classy.